Big Boy's Big Neighborhood, boy. Beautiful day in the neighborhood, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not saying it's beautiful just because Anthony Ramos walked into the neighborhood. How you doing, my guy?
I'm so good.
Man, welcome to the neighborhood.
Thank you.
I don't know how we interview you because there's some people when they come into the neighborhood, we kind of just go and it's that one thing. What do I talk to you about? Do I talk to you about Broadway? Do I talk to you about music? Do I talk to you about film? Do I talk to you about being a sous chef? Do I talk to you about an acrobat, break dancer? You know, let's just talk to Anthony Ramos.
All right.
Welcome to the neighborhood, bro. You just celebrated a birthday?
I did, November 1st.
What did you do for your birthday?
I had my first show on tour.
Oh, really, though?
Yeah.
Was that on purpose?
Sort of. Yeah, kind of.
So did it get corny where you made sure they sung happy birthday to you? Because I know I would.
No, they did it on their own.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, I didn't ask for that. They just started singing happy birthday to the audience, and I was like, wow, this is crazy.
Do you get a lot of birthdays in the business where you're not at home?
Yeah. Unfortunately, right, but. But
you know what that's called? It's called working.
It's called working, man. You know what I'm saying? Keeping the lights on is what that's called.
What was it like being on tour, celebrating your birthday, and having them scream out and sing happy birthday to you?
It was amazing. I mean, my family, you know, I had a lot of family members that flew out for the show. And you know, my mother was there, my brother, and I had friends from New York just coming from all over the place to come see the show. And it was just mad special. We sold it out in Chicago, which was you know, really special. We sold it out on the day too, which was crazy. Like, you know, and it was packed, and it was just so much love in the room, and it was dope to celebrate life, period, that night, just singing songs about my life.
You know what's dope about that too, though, man, is you're in a position where it seems like you have a love for music. Yeah. And then you kind of throw things up against the wall and it's like, okay, well, this is kind of taking off as well.
Yeah.
Did you ever kind of put music to a side because other things are going on as far as releasing? I know music is always in you, but did you ever have to concentrate on something else at the moment?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, acting is a big part of my life. You know, that's just as important to me as music, you know, but it just kind of like, it really happened. I just try to follow whatever is the vibe. Like, I'm like, yo, if I'm feeling like I want to write for, you know, I've stopped acting for 3 months. I called my agent. I'll never forget. I called them and I was like, yo, so I'm not going to act for like the first third of the year.
Your agent was like,
wait, what you mean? You're not going to act? What are you talking about, bro? Like, if you ain't making money, we ain't making money, son.
Yeah.
We're both in this.
I was like, yeah, nah. I was like, I'm going to write.
So you shut yourself down?
Shut yourself down
out here? In Burbank?
And I just came to Burbank. Which is kind of crazy. I came here to Burbank, and I at a studio, 1011 North Lake Street, we had this little room. Me and my best friend, my boy, who was working on the music team off Broadway at Hamilton at the time. And he came up to me and was like, yo, bro, like, the way we even, like, started writing, where he was like, yo, like, everybody on that stage is mad talented, but, like, bro, like, you special.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like,
he was like, get away from me.
I was like, bro, I'm thank you. That's nice of you. But then he's like, you ever made a record? I was like, nah. He's like, you ever wanted to do that?
Damn.
I was like, yeah. And he's like, we should talk about that. So we, over tacos.
Right. Hello.
Nice.
A couple days later.
Some of the best conversations happen over tacos.
I'm just saying, Gotham Market, down the block.
Go ahead now. We'll go there.
We went in New York. And we just talked. And we were getting to know each other a little more. And then, like, we wrote our first song together. And then,
had you always been a writer?
I was writing a little bit, you know, I was writing, but, again, my focus was like, and like you said, you were right. Like, sometimes your focus is sometimes shifted. Sometimes, you know, I was really focused on acting. I was like, you know, I was going to musical theater school even before that. And like, I got in like, yo, like, I didn't know nothing about musicals.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Right,
I didn't know
damn.
Anything about music. I got in, like, they would probably saw late, like, ah, he got something. He got some kind of raw talent. Let's, like, get him into school.
Yeah.
And I get into school, and I felt behind.
Wow.
I was like, you know, I was with all these kids, all these students who knew
been there for
Rodgers
years,
and Hammerstein is and Steven Sondheim and all these people who have written these amazing musicals. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yo, I don't know any of these people.
So you were really tuitioning into the school of experience, like hands-on.
Yeah. Like, I was in the school staying from like 8 a.m. to 11 p.m. because I was like, yo, I got to catch up.
The drive is different then.
Yeah, I mean, I had to just work a little harder. And plus, like, you know, I'm Latino. Mm-hmm. Like, if nobody was in a rush to write a role, a lead role for a Latin, barely 5'9", freckled dude. You know what I'm saying? 155 wet. They're like, oh my gosh, we got the next Brad Pitt.
Hey, man, you looking for at the breakdown? Like, nah, that's not me.
No, I was
you
like, know? No. They're like 6'1", not whatever, buff. And I'm like, yo.
How do you penetrate that? You know what I'm saying? The we're looking for and the types. Does it feel like we as a so-called minority, we're getting more work?
It definitely feels like we're getting more right. work, for sure. But we have to write our own stories.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's the thing. Like, I feel like for many years, right, we look at the right, you ask anybody, all right, who's your favorite actor? Most of the time, they'll tell you somebody that don't look like them.
Right. Mm-hmm. I hear you.
Most of the time. Right now, it's starting to get, right, we're getting more, especially like in the black community, man. I feel like it's amazing with Black Panther. Like, there's so many incredible, monumental movies and things that are happening, right? Like, Tyler Perry opened his own studio in Atlanta.
On Confederate grounds,
that's
bro.
That's big for the culture, yo.
Yeah, it is.
You know what I'm saying? And, like, that's... That right there is mm-hmm. is it, when we can do that, right? Like, and I'm like, okay, all right, the Latinx community, everybody, like, yo, let's go, let's get with the, you know, Crazy Rich Asians happen, like, right?
We need our own.
We need to expand. We need to write our own story. Nobody's gonna write it for us. People mm-hmm. gonna write about what they know.
Yeah, if man. And sometimes that's the worst. You know what I'm saying?
Like, they're not gonna write. No one's writing me a role because they. Most people in Hollywood ain't growing up the way I did.
At the time we need you the most, you pivot and go do an album.
I had to do it.
Jesus Christ. Hey, man, so the good and the bad, that's the first runoff for you? That's crazy, and bro. So,
you know, this album.
Did you grow up with music?
I did. You know, when I was in high school, my cousins rapped. Mm-hmm. You know, we used to share.
Did you ever try that?
You know, I
was, a little table.
I was dipping and dabbing, you know? Until I got, you know, and then I got the Broadway in Hamilton, and they were like, nah, son, you got to spit.
Yeah. Let's go. That's a whole different world. We're going to get to that.
But, you know, in high school, we had this Dell computer. And so we had the computer on the desktop, and we had this little mic that just kind of extended barely past the keyboard, mm-hmm. and the mic was like mad small. And then we had to record. So what my cousins would write in their raps, and I would listen to them rapping. I'm like, yo, can I write a hook? Let me just like try to write a little hook. And they were like, all right, let's see what you got, right? Testing me out. Yeah. They're like, all right, let's see. So I write a little hook. And what we would do is we would steal beats off the internet.
Hell yeah.
And put them, drag them to the
go
Windows
ahead.
Media
Talk
player.
Talk about a thief. Go ahead.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, yeah,
you know, telling yourself, Tekashi 6ix9ine, but go ahead.
I ain't putting that on you.
Oh, my God.
You snitching on yourself.
You.
I shot that man, Your Honor.
Oh, my.
That was my
It's getting dark. Let's bring back light.
Yeah.
But anyway, look, long story short, I like, that's when somebody's about to tell a long story. They fucking say
long story short. We do that all the time. Right. Long story short.
But it's we had this little mic. We dragged the beat from the internet, put it on the Windows Media Player. We pull up the voice memo app on the computer, and we click play on the voice memo, switch over to Windows Media Player, play on the beat, and then we had to record the song in one take.
Yeah, man.
And if you didn't, we had to start over, and we'd be up to the wee hours of the night trying to make sure that we got it right. So I started writing like that, and then I stopped a little bit. Then I got back to college. I met two of my homies, my boy Tom and Joel. I met them, and they were writing. So I started freestyling with them. I'd be freestyling with them in the studio, you know, just like we rent out a studio for an hour, and they'd be playing guitar, piano, and I would just sing, you know, vocals or whatever. And then later on, I just continued. I kept going. Yeah. I kept going, and I would always do. I would do it on the low though. Like it was really just like
was
a thing
it in
I did
your
for myself.
Head to lead up to like solo artist or I'm prepping an album. Was that in you at the moment, or you just felt like you were putting in the outliers 10,000 hours? Like
the 10,000 hours.
Yeah,
man. I think you know. I wasn't really thinking up. I'd always think up, you know, concepts or be like, oh, that'd be a cool story to write an album mm-hmm. about. But like, you know, I also was broke. So that's another thing. You need a little bit of money to make music sometimes.
Yeah, a lot of dreams
too.
Don't pay the bill. When you're like, hey, the rent is due. You're like, nah, I got dreams. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I'll be back, you know?
Hey, dreams.
Where's your cousins at now that you started with and the little homies from school?
My cousin is, one of them is in the Army. Mm-hmm. And the other one, he lives in Queens, Darrell, with his wife and his.
When they saw you taking off, and when they were like the guys and you was like, oh, I'll just do a little hook. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know, and now you like the guy. Is everything good? Because I'm going to tell you straight up, maybe I'm a little bit, I would be salty. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I would be like, man, I would be the one, and excuse my English, because I'm not going to say it in French. I would be outside and be like, hey, man, fuck Hamilton. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, why are you so upset? I'm like, man, fuck Savage. Anthony. You know what I'm saying? And then they realize, like, oh, that was his cousin. Yeah. He was bitter. No, but there's nothing like that.
Nah, my cousin was at my show. The one in the army. He was at the show hype.
Okay,
in the back
dope.
Singing every word. Yo.
That's dope.
That's going to be a little different experience being, like, on the stage in Hamilton, and you know, like, you can probably see people mouthing words. No, the people love the soundtrack, but now going to your show and seeing people sing the words that you wrote.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Right?
And you just never know, because you locked in the studio, you know, and this is my first album, and like, you know, like, you, I would tell my friends, I was genuinely like, this, we just finished tour 2 days ago, and I was like shocked at when people, I saw people in the audience. And then at that, a full audience, I was like, yo, motherfucker showed up.
Hey, man, is it crazy that people, like, do you still get that feeling, Ant, where you're like, dude, I'm on their calendar. They got dressed. They made sure they purchased tickets. You know what I'm saying? Crazy. And it's not like if you're on a show, it's one of many where they kind of snuck you in a festival and you got a time slot.
Right. No, people came to see whatever. Like, some people didn't even know what they were. They were just like, yo, I just came because my friend was like, and like, I'm seeing, yo, some of these messages are like I was blown away. I got emotional yesterday just sitting by myself reflecting on what this tour was. Like, you know, this couple came up to me after my show in Brooklyn and they said, yo, we've been together 18 years and this is our first concert together.
Damn.
They said, so things have come up because of our kids. Things have come up because of life. But we just wanted to say that this is our first concert together. And we had to come to this one because you were playing. And I like looked at my man and I almost gave him the waterworks. I was like, you know, when the bottom lip quivers and you got to like hit the chest like a dude. And I was like, yo, man, thank you, bud. I appreciate you, man. Like, yeah, so much. Like, thank you.
But you know what it is too, man? It's when you go blood, sweat, and tears. And when you say you lock yourself up, you record something, you step out on faith, even if you can't see the whole staircase.
Yeah.
And it's like you take it. Then when you release it to the world, you're kind of like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And we are so quick and critical. The first thing we do, sometimes we fold our arms.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Social media. We don't want to say anything nice. We want to tear you up.
We don't want to like nothing.
Yeah, we like, but we live there. You know what I'm saying? So when you get someone that comes and say, hey man, we were together 18 years, it's like those things mean something.
They mean more
because
you
created
know,
a moment for them. Yeah. And you created a moment, like, not even knowing, like, oh, when I write this, man, somebody's going to come up to me and they're going to say they've never been to a con. That's what I'm trying to write this for.
Yeah.
And it's really authentic, man. So when you say I was about to turn on the waterworks, it was earned.
Yeah. I mean, this girl came up to me and said, yo, man, like, all week I've had so much anxiety and you, and like, after I came to your show, I just realized everything was going to be okay. Mm-hmm. And I was like,
and you know what's crazy, man, is that it's just, it feels like it's snowballing. You know what I'm saying? Where it's like, okay, you got a following, but does it feel like it's getting bigger and bigger? Like, are you watching it grow?
Yeah. I mean, but I think I was so focused on the growth at first, but now I've kind of shifted my gears and I'm kind of putting my head down and just focusing on what's in front of me, right? Like, what's in front of me are y'all right now, right? So this is my focus. I'm not focused on anybody else. I'm not focused on anything else. I'm just here to have this moment with you right now.
I heard that.
I don't care about what's coming in the next few minutes, right? Mm-hmm. And I think my mindset before was like, it's got to explode right now.
Right, right, right.
We got it. This, everything's got to happen right now and this moment. And I'm just, and my vision was like, I was just looking at the mountains instead of just looking at the thing, instead of looking at the thing right in front of me. Like, yo, just focus on.
Looking way over there.
Just focus on that person that you're looking at right now and don't look around. You ever been at a party and you see the people, you ever been in one of them parties and people are talking to you, but they looking around and see if there's somebody else more interesting that they're supposed to be talking to.
I get it all the time.
And I was doing that with this music and I said, I need to shift my focus and I need to focus on that person in front of me.
I heard
you know
that.
What I'm saying?
Is that why you decided to do most of it here in LA rather than like back home?
Yeah, it helps when you ain't got distractions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You're lucky we didn't know you were here because we would have knocked on the door like, Aunt, you in there?
Let's go.
Yeah, you writing?
I love always the discovery welcome. Though with it too, because like at one point when you're listening to the songs and the stories, you're finding out that you didn't have to go like very far to realize that you already have everything that you that's in you. You know what I mean? That self-discovery. What other emotions did you go through writing this album?
This whole album became about, you know, and in the shows I make a joke, but I say this album is about a character in our story, and then I tell the audience, like, yo, like, when I say the character in our story, you can say you. Mm-hmm. And I point to myself, and they're like, you! And I'm like, yeah, this guy,
like,
me. Yeah.
Like, y'all figured me out.
And it's like, this album became about a guy who thought he needed to run away from home to figure out who he wanted to be in life and realize at the end of the album that all the answers I ever needed, right? He went through the good and the bad. Mm-hmm. And we call it the good and the bad because I don't feel like life is about the good moment or the bad moment. It's about the journey in between that took you from that good moment to the bad moment and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And that's what this album is about. It's about this guy going through, he leaves in Dear Diary, goes through the good and the bad, goes on his journey, goes to the industry party in Auntie Basement, and realizes that there's nothing like partying with people you love in a place that's most familiar, right? Yeah. And then he has this long night, one more hour, meets this person. That's about the first time my fiance and I kissed.
Oh.
Right? But like, right, we keep going on the journey, right? They take a spontaneous trip. We actually did. I booked us a trip to Puerto Rico. She didn't know. I was like, please cancel what you got going on. She was like, I have a life. I'm like, can you cancel your life?
Right.
Please.
Yeah, I'm
right?
Here.
And we go on, and right, we go on, right? They're making love, passionate love. I was like, we hear a lot of songs about people just having one night stands. Where's the song for people who've been together for like mad long?
Mm-hmm.
People who are like working it out, right? Mm-hmm. People who've been two years, 5 years, 15 years, like, right? Mind over matter, right? I'm like, when we're making love, real love, we take it deeper, mind over matter. I said, I need that song because that's my life. That's I don't live that other life. Mm-hmm. Some people do, and God bless, right? If you do,
right.
That's not my shit.
He looked over at Monica. He was like, if you do, Monica, then you know.
Monica?
Yeah, that's your thing. You know what I'm
Monica, do your thing, baby. You know what I'm saying?
Now, you talked about your fiance.
Yes.
I heard that. And you, yeah, congrats on that, bro. And when and how did you do the whole proposal?
Oh man, so we met doing Hamilton, and I saw her in rehearsal. And I was like, damn, hey, whoa. And then,
did you guys have to keep it a secret for a while?
We did, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we did. But, and I even talk about the bar that we used to hang out with in the song One More Hour. I talk about the pregame at Swift, after work sipping, one drink to two till we on the train trip. And Swift was the bar around the corner from where we.
Now watch everybody gonna go there.
Yeah. Swift.
Any ladies in here?
Free drinks, please, Swift.
Yeah, you know
I gave y'all a lot of money.
Hell yeah.
But we used to chill there, and we met there. And we kept it a secret a little while, but then our director called us.
Oh,
and then he basically was like, don't fuck up my show.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, stop it.
We was like, we got you, bro. Right. We got you. It was good. We were in it together for a year and a half, and we did it, and it was great. And then I proposed to her on Christmas Eve last year, almost a year from.
How did you do that?
So we were in England.
Mm-hmm.
That's where her family's from.
Oh.
And
like England.
Like England. Like,
oh, wow.
Yeah.
I heard that.
Yeah.
Go ahead with
across
your
the pond.
Yes.
And I was like, I hit her mom up and I was like, yo, look, I said, can you please give me Jasmine's three favorite places as a child? Like that they used to take her, like her three favorite spots. And she gave me three spots. But we also wanted her grandmother to be there, who's 87.
Wow.
So that was really important. So we said, we need to pick a place that's easy for her grandmother to get to and meets all the bullet
criteria.
Points, but it's easy for her grandmother to get to. So we picked Arundel Castle in a town called Arundel. And I just did it right in front of there. Yo, I had some help. Thank God my family helped out. We had a camera dude out there.
Man,
who almost blew up the spot. I was like, yo, hide behind the tree, bro. Until we give you the cue.
Oh, my
what are you doing?
Like, man, I didn't come this far and do all this prep work.
For your ass. But,
yeah.
You know?
Hey, like, isn't that Gary with the camera
right
there?
Like, but he still
what is
kept
he doing
he was
here?
Like, he was filming next to us. And then thank God my fiance's cousin was like, oh, surely he's not here for us. He's here for somebody else.
Oh, he did a good pivot
for you. Yeah, so he had to do the pivot because I was like, yo, my mans, what are we doing over here, bro?
But you can tell you put a lot of thought into it, too.
Yeah, no, I definitely did. I wanted to make it special. Hopefully, right? Hopefully, you get
that's
engaged
beautiful.
Once.
Yeah.
And
yeah, that's it.
Right? You know
one and done.
Are you guys already planning the wedding or?
Yeah, so we were talking about it yesterday. So we're about to look at venues. We're going to look at some venues next week. But so I'm super excited about that because we've been mad busy and we just couldn't do it. Finally, we like bunk, you know, we've been locking it down. We like, all right, let's go. Let's make this shit happen before we, you know, never.
Yeah. Look, it'll be 10 years, be 18
like,
years.
That time we was going to get married?
Yeah, like, remember back in the old decade when we said, I got to ask you now, Hamilton.
Yeah.
Natalia, Hamilton. I enjoyed Hamilton. She went to Hamilton 50, 60 times. You know what I'm saying?
Did you go to New York? Did you come to
New York? No, I never got to go to New York, but I listened to the soundtrack the moment it came out. And so, like, by the time it came to LA, I was like having to hold my mouth shut because I was like, I want to sing everywhere.
Yeah.
But it was
Hamilton
great.
Hamilton was and, dope, I mean, bro.
So you did. Yeah.
Did you come to New York?
You went to New York and you brought me back stuff.
I did New York and I did when we were out here. Mm-hmm.
Did you see the original cast? Did you see our cast?
No, man, nah, bro.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's nah.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
What but a great cast too. Like, I know everyone who's already like taken on the roles as well is amazing, but when you look back and you see just Lynn being in there and you and I mean, it's just the talent is so unreal.
How hard and challenging is that though?
It was hard. It's 8 shows a week, man. Like that, you know. That you ain't no that's you can't run from that.
And how long did you do Hamilton?
I mean, I was in it even in a workshop, like way back when, like, so we did a 4-week like lab, a developmental lab. We were developing the show. Damn. And I got in like that on open call. I had no agent, no nothing. And I just walked up in Telsey and it just so happened to be empty that day. And I was on my way to like rehearsal for some other thing I did that got canceled.
Ooh.
Damn. But this is Hamilton before we knew the phenomenon,
right.
Hamilton, like not knowing. You know, it's this, but not knowing what this was about to become.
Right.
Can I tell you my Hamilton real quick story, though?
Please.
So I'm a huge Lin fan, Lin-Manuel. Like, In the Heights is my favorite musical. He came here to do some promotion, and I had seen the performance that he did for Barack. I recorded it onto a computer and would listen to it in my car.
That's
like,
crazy.
No joke. So when he came here, I was like, by the way. And there was no talks of it ever. And I was like, by the way, that Hamilton mixtape thing that you did, I was like, I love it. I listen to it all the time. I was like, are you going to do something with it one day? And he was like, well, you know, you never know. And I like, fast forward years later, I was like.
He put Hamilton together. He didn't trust you enough to tell you what he was really doing.
He did. He was like, nah, I can't give you all the tea.
He was like, yeah, I met some girl. She asked him, like, what am I doing?
She was all up in my business.
She stole the video off of YouTube.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Oh, no, piracy ass. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't need her all in my business.
I did.
So you walk in not knowing I don't have an agent.
Nothing.
No representation. Another
open audition. It was for some other show. It wasn't even for Hamilton. It was like some other show that was auditioning, and I like walk up in there. I sang Ain't Too Proud to Beg from the Temptations.
If Ooh. I have to sleep on your doorstep all night and day, just to keep you.
Only thing
from
left for me
away.
Was to get on my knees and open the shirt.
Yeah.
But it was, the casting director could not have felt further away from me. I mean, it was crazy. Like, those auditions be feeling like you walk up in there and it's so vulnerable, man, because you're just like singing your heart out, and then all they, you know, they're like, good job.
Thank you.
Damn. And you just walk out and you're just like.
You walk out like, didn't nail that.
You're just like, let me go find my soul real quick. Let me go find that shit somewhere in this building.
When do you get the call back that you're going to be a part of the workshop that leads into Hamilton?
So
how long does that take?
I did 4 auditions after that. And then I did 3 after that. So I did 4 in total. And then after the final one, I go to rehearsal for this show that was happening. At Radio City at the time, it was the equivalent of the Christmas Spectacular, but it was the Spring Spectacular. Mm. And we're in rehearsal for that. And I've been doing these auditions on the low because that shit was definitely not going to work out with that schedule.
Right.
But you know what I'm saying? You got to keep that shit right and tight.
Yeah.
Tight lip. So I was like, I'm going to rehearsal and I'm like, I don't know how this shit's going to work. They didn't know either, but they were like, we're still going to keep calling you back. And I go to rehearsal and there's a sign that says, hey, everybody, don't bother coming up to the don't bother signing in, come up to the large rehearsal hall, we have an announcement. I'm like, oh shit, announcement, hold up. I said, we fired.
Yeah, they about to start making cuts.
Yo,
damn.
And we go up to the large rehearsal hall and we get this announcement comes out, and they're like, everybody, we're gonna cancel the show a week before previews. And I had just done my final audition for Hamilton that morning. And for Lynn, for the whole squad.
So which show was being canceled?
The Radio City joint.
Wow.
That got canceled. 77 cast members. We all got laid off that
morning.
Wow. That afternoon. So everybody's like emptying the fridge of the alcohol and everybody's all depressed and shit. And like, well, we're going to have one last hoorah. And I get a call, like bling bling or whatever. And I go into the other room and they're like, hey, we heard about this other show. So we'd like to hire you for Hamilton's mixtape. That was the name at the time.
Yeah.
And they gave me the job, and I did a 4-week lab. I had 6 months off, and then I go on and I worked at a preschool, I worked at a bakery, I did what I had to do to fucking survive.
We knew this and that,
you know what I mean? And then I went, and then we did it off Broadway, and then we did it on Broadway, and then boom,
blew up.
And then shit happened, and fucking that worked with Spike Lee after that, and then I worked with Bradley Cooper, and all this shit just started happening, and then boom, this album, I got signed And then this album happened. It was crazy.
Damn.
So now it's artist time. That's the focus.
I mean, that's definitely that's where I'm at. I mean, I'm locked in, man.
Do you make resolutions? Is there a 2020 for you as far as like musically or what you want to see?
Yeah, I'm writing my second album next month. It's over. Yeah,
Why so fast? Well, it took you a while to write anyway, but why so fast when the momentum on this one is going?
Yeah, I just think it's just nice to have it.
Yeah,
I'm not necessarily gonna put it out.
Right, but you're always creating.
Though. But I still have things inside of me, and I have new stories to tell. I mean, I just did my first tour. Like, I mean, I got tons of shit to say now. Like, I'm engaged. Like, my life is different than it was when I wrote this Good and Bad album.
Right,
you know what I'm saying? And they're new things for me to say, new things on my heart. And I'm not necessarily gonna put the shit out. Like, I'm not gonna write it and be like, bang, bang, here you go, world.
Yeah,
here's the second one, let's go. But it's nice to have it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? And it's nice to get that
and
out of my system.
Perfect it and get it right.
And then continue to, and then I'll do a movie or whatever comes up, or and we'll see what's up. But I think right now my focus is to tell stories, man. And that's always my focus. I think as an artist, you know, we have a gift that we get to do this, right? This is a blessing, actually. Like, I get to go on stage and tell you a story. I get to take you on a journey for an hour and a half. Like, you came to this show for whatever reason, right? And so I get to do something that you, and I get to have an experience with you that you can't have by just listening to the album, right? We get to take it a little further. And now you get to listen to the album in a different way after this.
Yeah. Does all that stage prep you
I mean, you know.
Like, to perform, the tour, the highs, the lows, the sequence, everything. Cause the reason why I ask, Ant, is because there's some people, man, we're in such a melody-in society with artists. And you know what I'm saying? Like, it's almost like I'm here. You know what I'm saying? And you sing the song, or you know what I'm saying? It's like... And you don't feel like they're really putting anything into it.
I just think it's candy, man.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a lot of candy happening right now, and there's a lot of sugar, right? And we love that. We love sugar. Mm-hmm. Sugar's nice.
Yeah, it's addictive.
Right? Yes, it is. But then you get that low.
Yeah,
I'm trying
man.
To give people something that sustains.
Mm-hmm.
I'm giving you, and you know what? It's harder. Maybe I have to work harder.
Yeah.
Maybe I won't get a hit. Maybe, right? But... I have a responsibility as an artist, and I take it seriously, for me at least, right? Like, and I'm not saying other artists don't. I will never speak for any other artist. I just speak for myself that this is a gift that I get to share with you like this. This is anybody else could have been chosen to do this, but it's me who has the privilege to be in this studio and write a song and tell a story that hopefully you'll be able to hear. So I have a responsibility to share something with you that hopefully will make you feel something.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully will make you, I don't know, hopefully will give you something that you might not have had.
But you got that from music growing up too. You know what I'm saying? It's just crazy that now you supply that to other people, because music has always been everything for me, therapeutic. You know, my highs, my lows, my everything. Like, whatever I wanted to do in life at some particular moment, there's a soundtrack.
Right.
And you've had a soundtrack growing up from whatever music it was. Even when you say, I sung Ain't Too Proud to Beg, that's a hell of a song from somebody your age, and that's in your soundtrack.
Yo,
so now you become the soundtrack for someone else. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And the more you perform, and the more you see people come up to you and say, it's been 18 years of marriage, this is our first concert. Like, those stories will continue, and especially when we have good music, bro.
Yeah, man. It's a blessing, man. Like, these songs, you know, every song was something that happened to me, you know? And every song was about something, right? Like, you know, I wrote this song about a woman's love, right? Like, that song is... about all the women in my life that have loved me unconditionally, right? Mm-hmm. Like, unfortunately, I didn't have my dad in my life, right?
Same.
So a lot of women had to be that for me, and they had to really, like, I mean, the power of that kind of love, man. And I was like,
it's a different respect, too, though.
That's a different respect, right? And it's like, and And sometimes it's so amazing, right? Like the lyrics are, right? Yeah, I was, and the song came from, because the one woman in the studio at the time, mm-hmm. Amy Waj, this amazing writer from Wales, she was there and she was talking about her husband and her kids. And I was like, and I didn't know what to write about that day. I was like, yo, we got to write about that. Mm. We got to write about that kind of love. The love in which you're talking about them with, let's write a song about that. I want to be the ground that you land on, right? I want a woman's love, you can land. It's a strong surface. You can, anything can fall on that kind of love. And she'll handle it. She can that love don't will sustain, right? Shit, I want to be the rock you can stand on. That's that immovable. Like, you can't move that kind of love. That it's like, it's a rock, yo, right? And like, and like, I want to be the rock you can stand on. I wish that this love would go on and on and on. I think about the women, all the people who've loved me the most in my life, and like so unconditionally. And these, it was just woman, mom. Right, mm-hmm. My teacher Sarah Steinwise, my fiance, all these women, right? On, I wish that this love would go on and on and on, but I'm not around like we planned on. Right? I did the thing that some of us men, and I never speak for all men. I always say I ain't speaking for every guy, but some of us men, at least the men in my life that I've come across, some, right, at least half, 50% have left.
Yeah,
right. And but I'm not around like we planned on. I should have stayed, but I couldn't. Woman will stay. She'd be like, "Your ass is acting crazy," but we'll figure it out tomorrow.
Hell yeah.
I should have spoke, but I wouldn't. Right. She'll be like, "Let's figure it out. Let's get to the bottom of it." And I'm like, "Nah, I gotta go outside and clear my head."
Yeah.
Right. Should have spoke, but I wouldn't. And I did what I shouldn't. If I could have loved you like I was a woman, then maybe I would have loved you like crazy. But I did what I shouldn't. If I could have loved you like I was a woman, that this shit happened. These are all songs about just what I went through and what I'm going through still. Like, Figure It Out is a song about loneliness, yo. I still get lonely.
I love that.
I'd be fronting if I said I didn't.
Right.
You'd be in a room full of people and you still feel lonely. Mm-hmm. Like, room full of motherfuckers and you like, damn. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, I get it. I get it all the time. People, and it ain't about me. I got to write my own album.
I got to write my own album.
I'm in Burbank already. I need to lock myself away.
We all want to hear.
Now, where were you at? You at a studio over here? Watch that going there. It's not the same vibe. Like, damn.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
I guess you do got to be talented to do this. It's awesome, man. But, Ann, I thank you for coming into the neighborhood, man.
Thanks so much.
Before we leave, Natalia wanted 40 more minutes of your time.
Yes, I do. Yeah. No, next year, In the Heights is gonna come out. Oh, and this is a movie I've been waiting for a long time to happen.
Yes.
What is In the Heights mean to you, and how has it like been such a huge part of your career?
It means a lot to it means a lot to me, especially, you know, kind of how we started this conversation talking about, you know, people, us telling our stories. And you know, you see movies like Black Panther and Crazy Rich Asians, like, for the Latinx community, this is our Panther and our Crazy Rich Asians. Those movies are monumental and they did amazing things. So you never know what a movie's going to do, right? But for me and my heart and for the culture, this feels like that for me, right? To see 75, you know, Latin folk singing about Alza la Bandera, raising flags from all over Puerto Rico, Cuba, Dominican Republic, us in an alley, dancing in an alleyway in the hood, singing about pride.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I mean, I want to do movies for the rest of my life, but if I don't ever do another movie, I think I'm good.
That's the one.
Oh, I want so many people to see it. And I like it. Seriously, that musical has meant so much to me in my life, because the line where, you know, who would I be if my parents never left Puerto Rico? My dad's Puerto Rican. And so like that side meant so much to me that I can't wait for Latinos to come together to see it, to support it in that same way. And for you to be involved in Play Usnavi, and then Lynn is, you know, involved in, I think it's just such a beautiful, beautiful thing. And I just want to say thank you for being a part of it.
No, man.
I can't wait to see it.
I mean, I'm so happy you're excited about it.
I'm very excited. You
know, again, I'm grateful to be a part of it. I'm grateful that we get an opportunity to tell this story that for many years we just didn't have the opportunity. We just didn't. I saw In the Heights in college. I wanted to quit because of what I said earlier. Like, nobody was in a rush to write a role. Like, I was like, where do I fit in this world? I don't fit in here.
Mm-hmm.
And I sat in that audience. I never forget. I pulled my college bought up a few tickets before the show was closing. And I pulled one of them little pamphlets out, a little piece of paper that you had to submit at the box office.
Yeah.
And I went by myself. And I sat in that audience and I was like, oh shit. I was like, I don't only relate to these people, I know them. I know, like, that guy right there is Leo from the corner store.
Damn.
Oh, that character is
it crazy
Tiffy.
That you fast forward and now you're a spectator in the audience.
Yo.
And you fast forward and now you're a part of that.
It blew my mind.
Every day, man, you can't write it, huh?
You just can't.
Yeah,
I just
man.
can't. I can't, you know what I'm saying? I could try to make sense of it. here you with y'all, bro. But I, you know, it's you know, but it's a, again, it's a gift. I did. Anybody else could have, they could have picked anybody else to play this role.
Anthony, man, it was a pleasure sitting down with you, bro.
Thank you so much.
Believe that, man, and I'm glad we had a moment to do this.
Me
and
too.
I'll continue to look after you. I'll continue and make sure that you come back to the neighborhood.
I would love.
Don't
to.
Don't do
man.
No one and done. You know what I'm saying?
I would love
yeah,
to.
Yeah, don't do what I won't say the person's name, but yeah, don't do that. You know what I'm saying? All righty, the good, the bad, available on all formats. However we could grab our music, make sure y'all go ahead and get that, man. And continue to stop by and say hello to the neighborhood, bro. Appreciate
you. Thanks for having me in the neighborhood.
Y'all stick around, man. Big Boys Neighborhood.